Yo, Ben.
Hello, Nigel. How you doing?
I'm very good, mate. Very good.
It's great
Lovely.
to speak to you after so long.
It is. It's good to catch up. It's been quite a few years, isn't it? When did we last see each other? About 2010?
Yeah, I used to attend your events. For people listening, why don't you describe your land and the forest and all that?
Yes, well, we're very fortunate to have a small holding here in Hertfordshire. It's about 3 acres or so, not very big, and it's kind of been a labor of love over the last 20 years or so, really. It started as a sort of a blank canvas in that it was broadly sort of rejuvenated woodland and a bit of open space. And yeah, it's been an ongoing process of developing that, but in the what I'd like to call the best sense of the word development. Most people think of development as putting up a block of flats and, building a new housing estate. But developing as in, creating a vegetable growing area, digging a pond, putting up fences and sort of rabbit control techniques, planting trees, creating zones for, for keeping chickens, growing willow, this sort of thing. So it's been an ongoing process. As I said, over about 20 years, and it's a labor of love. It's great.
You're living a dream that a lot of people have. A lot of people aspire to live on the land and do the kind of things you're doing. So, where did you inherit that? Were your parents, like country people as well, or was this your own dream to do this?
Yes, I was very fortunate to inherit the land. From my grandparents, sort of via my father very briefly, though he never did anything with it. And I currently actually sort of co-own the full 7 acres with my sister, actually. So we've just agreed to sort of split it in two. But it's been interesting because I sort of got into the green movement in the 90s and became very keen to, initially sort of just set up a vegetable growing sort of like an allotment set up, and that was the initial drive. And I quickly found out just how much joy there is to be experienced in creating, if you like, on a 3D canvas and creating a space, an environment, a it's more than a space environment. It's a place to be that's, your own creation. It's quite difficult to describe. When you grow trees and things, you're creating this whole, lovely place to hang out. And I must add, of course, that unfortunately the government doesn't allow us to live here, so it isn't quite the dream it could be. But hopefully, one day they might deign to allow me to live on my own land.
Well, the last time that we were properly in touch, you were in the process of doing the planning permission. You were in a legal battle with the local authorities. I know at some point you lost that battle, but I don't really know what happened after that. I mean, clearly you're still living there. So what happened?
Yes, I challenged the government through obviously the government representation at the local council level. It was during the Freeman movement of sort of 2008, 2009, when I became buoyed up with the idea that. It's a bit of a complicated story, but I'll try and summarize it as briefly as I can. The idea that really governments only have jurisdiction over paperwork entities, legal fictions. So I was buoyed up with this idea that really they couldn't stop me from living on my land, or rather they didn't have legitimate jurisdiction to prevent a man from living on using his own property. And this, as you pointed out, gave rise to this legal challenge, and I went through that. It took about 2 or 3 years, I think, nearly. And I was essentially asking the government to prove that I needed planning permission to be on my land, and ultimately they failed to do this. And all they would the only issue that they would actually entertain or examine was, did I obey their rules or not? They wouldn't allow me to challenge or ask the question legitimately in court, am I actually obligated to follow your rules, which is, if you like, an antecedent point to whether or not I obey them. So before we talk about whether you need to obey them, first of all, are you subject to them? And of course, well, not of course, but they wouldn't entertain this issue. And I went through to the Crown Court, but I wasn't even allowed, interestingly enough, to mention the issue to the jury. I wasn't allowed to talk about the reason that I was there. The only reason they wanted to discuss was, did I follow the rules? Mm. So I lost that case. And we were subsequently evicted from our nest of yurts. We were living the dream back then. Between 2009 and 2012, we spent 3 years living in a nest of four yurts, which was absolutely fantastic. I couldn't recommend it more. And I was forced to move off into local rented accommodation. And to this day, we don't officially live here. We live in Nebworth, just nearby. But we spend, you know, almost all of our time here.
Mm, I see. So it's a sort of technicality. Yeah, I mean, me and you went through a similar journey with all the free man on the land stuff, which is why we know each other, because we were on a similar path at the same time. I mean, I didn't own land, but I was sort of challenging the government in other ways, you know, like with the driving license and tax and things like that. Ultimately, I decided it was futile, you know, that the idea that we are sovereign and we the people grant the government, you know, permission to rule us, really, I decided was, there wasn't much reality to that. The reality is the government rules us by force, and that's that. You know, the courts impose their rules, and as much as we would like it to be different, it's not different. And so I kind of just accepted that and gave up the fight in a way. But did you come to the same conclusion, or where are you at with that?
I did come to the same conclusion. I think you're spot on. And I came to the conclusion, because part of the reason for my challenge of the process, if you like, was to find out, am I free? So it was suggested to me that you know, governments don't have this legitimate jurisdiction. So I thought, well, let's test this. Let's, you know, and I thought that the most fundamental issue you could test it with would be, can I live on my own land? So it's essentially testing property rights, because without property rights, you know, the right to use, own and dispose of property, and it could be land property in my case, or it could be, you know, any property that you might own, any stuff. And so I elected to test this. And of course, I found out, as you pointed out, that the government wouldn't listen. They simply enforced very much with force their decision. And I had to capitulate. I was left with no alternative. Jail. I was facing jail if I'd carried on my fight. So essentially, the conclusion I drew was, OK, well, I'm not politically free. So To me, the concept of freedom has two components. It has obviously political freedom. Are you in a cage or not? Are you able to act upon your own judgment or not? And also, I see another component, which is, am I psychologically free? Am I intellectually free? Am I a sovereign individual in terms of my thinking and my mind? And so this sort of pertains to, am I led around by other people? Am I following, or am I an individual who's authoring his own life? I think this is a very important component of freedom. And unfortunately, I concluded that is the only aspect of freedom that I'm able to exercise at this time. So, yes, like you, I did essentially give up on that optimistic note. It was worth challenging, and I think I remember you challenging it in other ways too, but unfortunately I had to draw the same conclusion as you.
Yeah, I think that's a really smart distinction you made there, Nigel. You know, I mean, relatively speaking, we're pretty free, aren't we? You know, we can pretty much walk around and do what we want. We're in a kind of soft prison of laws and taxes that, you know, there's no practical way out of. And I think it's really smart to identify the things that we do have influence over and the things we don't have influence over. And, you know, in amongst the liberty, sovereign, free man movement, I do admire that that passion for freedom and to stand up for individual liberties. But there's also a kind of, a lot of the time, there's a naivety with it of conflating the way the world should be with the way the world is, and not really intelligently distinguishing the difference, you know. And it, there's a lot of people like perhaps myself and yourself included that have got themselves in a lot of trouble through, well, I don't know if me and you were dogmatic, like you say, we were treating it as an experiment, but some people dogmatically insist that, you know, they should be free, and they really get themselves in trouble in court, in prison, you know. It's dangerous stuff, you know, poking and prodding at the government, isn't it?
It is. And do you know what, I think that it's a case of, I mean, we are quite free, as you say, but it's rather like the analogy of sort of free range animals on the farm. So as long as you don't go too near the perimeter fence, or as long as you don't attempt to break the perimeter fence, politically speaking, which is a metaphor for what I was trying to do, as long as you don't do that, as long as you stay within the confines of the freedom that we're granted, you're okay. And as you pointed out, we are pretty free. There are a lot of freedoms we enjoy, but ultimately we're not free. That was the conclusion that I drew. And as you said also, it there's no point in banging our heads against the wall. And I think ultimately we have to pick battles. So there's no way these days I would take issue with any of the government regulations. These days, if they came after me for anything, if I got a parking ticket, I would probably just pay it and say, do you know what? Because my time is precious, and I've learned that I want to spend it doing what I want to do. And I don't want to spend it immersed in paperwork. I've tried that and I've learned through it, and it's very useful. But these days I would just pay off whoever I own, you know, whatever. I would deal with it and quickly move my attention and free myself up. I don't want to prod the beast. I don't want to engage with the enemy in any way, shape or form. So I try to keep myself to myself, away from this entity called government, who I now see as my adversary, if not enemy, because the government has proved to me that they are contrary to my best interests. I know that my best interests lie in pursuing my future and whatever I can on my own piece of land, and the government have made it clear that I'm not allowed to do this. And yes, it's a question of picking battles, enjoying the freedom that we do have, but at the same time, I think it's important to pursue this ultimate goal of complete political freedom, because I very much see it as the answer to, as part of the answer to humanity's problems. Rational thinking things through, and ultimately freedom is an extension of that.
Yeah, I completely agree, Nigel. Now, I noticed I was on the Spaniard's Facebook page, and I haven't spoken to him for a long time, but I noticed you've got a new festival coming up this summer, Outside the Matrix Summer Festival. So is this the first one in a while?
It is. We had one about 3 years ago, which was good. That explored a lot of the health issue, if you like, and a lot of the psychological requirements of being free. And yes, we're going to do it again this May, on the end of May bank holiday weekend. And we're very excited about that, actually, because it's an ongoing conversation, and the issues of people wanting to, you know, to be freer, to fully author their own destiny, if you like, and to step outside of this whole sort of mainstream narrative, which is really what this festival is about. There's still a demand for it, and it's very much still what I'm about. So yeah, we're very pleased to be doing that again this year.
Yeah, fantastic. It was a lot of fun. I've got really fond memories. I think I came maybe a couple of times. I don't really remember. Was it two or three times,
right?
I came?
I'm sure you came at least twice, yes, because we did a couple events, I think 2 1 year, and I think over three successive years, we probably did one on 2 years, and on the third year, we did two. So I'm sure we saw you on at least two occasions.
Yeah, I think so. I've got fond memories, a lot of fun, and your woodland there is really picturesque, and it's lovely how you've created it. I mean, I've got mixed feelings about the information, you know, when like we were just discussing, I've got a lot of mixed feelings about the information with the legal lawful stuff. But I think
the conversation has really moved on since then. Forgive me for interjecting there. But for me, it's very much moved on because, like you, I've put that to rest. And as I said, we pick battles. We don't. I'm not going to go back and engage with this monster again. So it's a different emphasis now. And I mean, I consider the Matrix this whole mainstream cultural download that most people buy into almost automatically and by default, in the absence of thinking and arriving at their own conclusions, having investigated, having thought things through, having joined dots in their own minds, it's a challenge. And I think the ultimate challenge these days to lead any kind of successful life is to ultimately learn to trust our own judgment, which means being intellectually sovereign and psychologically independent and so forth, because the present day context is so full of disinformation and problems. I mean, you can't look sideways these days and follow other people if, for example, you want to be healthy, because there's so much disinformation put out. You know, we could go into about the pharmaceutical influence and the vested interests, the various government information, which is all back to front. And so given we have this context where, you know, we're in the information age, but it's the disinformation age. We've got this soup of data and we have to figure out what's true and what's not. Mm. And this is the context into which we want successful lives and the core foundation of success. The core foundation of a successful life is, of course, having a functional mind and body, and hence why health is a crucial topic that people would do well to look into.
Anybody who's into alternative thinking, I know on your podcast you cover a broad range of topics to do with living outside the Matrix, don't you? So anybody into health or nature or anything, or, you know, political activism will probably enjoy the event, I'd imagine.
Yes, it is a broad event, and as I said, health is one component of it. Understanding the nature of our context is very much another. So, you know, this touches into that picking your battles and so forth. And yeah, being very mindful of the need, I think, to really become an independent thinker. That's really, I think, where the heart of the solution lies.
Mm. Who do you follow in terms of information? Like, who do you read? Who do you watch?
Good question. Yes, for health, there are all sorts of people I like to listen to. Dr. David Perlmutter, Dr. McCullough, Dr. Dietrich Klinghart, Dr. Darren Schmidt, you know, people like this. There are an awful lot of Dr. Zach Bush. There's some wonderful minds out there uncovering the truth and integrating it together, joining the dots and challenging the conventional system with regards to health. And, you know, just on the example of health, for example, we know that you can't go to your doctor to find out how to be healthy. And there's a number of reasons for this. Firstly, he thinks that all of these chronic diseases are essentially genetic. And given that all of these modern chronic diseases are in epidemic proportions, we have to note that you can't have an epidemic of a genetic disease. This is one of the problems. Also, he tends to treat symptoms rather than address causes. You know, that's not going anywhere. You know, you don't need to be a genius to know that if you don't address the root causes, you're not really going to fundamentally change anything. So, also, you know, that the way they hand out antibiotics, all of this sort of stuff, nothing on nutrition. So we know that you can't ask your doctor, no matter how well-meaning he is. And I, you know, don't mean to speak against doctors. I've got some best friends that are doctors, but it's that's the paradigm that they come from, I don't think, is addressing the issues. So that's an example. I mean, who do I listen to with regards to thinking? I'm a great fan of Ayn Rand and her philosophy of objectivism. My favorite book is her classic Atlas Shrugged.
Yeah.
And that informs my thinking. There's a couple of people. I mean, David Kelly, he's written extensively on the art of reasoning and so forth. So there's a couple. Who's the other chap who wrote a great book? Square One. I think it's Patterson. Somebody Patterson. He has a podcast. Patterson in Pursuit. That's right. He wrote a wonderful book, Square One, which is sort of boiling things right down to the essentials, some philosophical fundamentals and thinking techniques that enable us to really make sure that we're uncovering truth. Because as we mentioned a while ago, we've got this huge soup of data, and the challenge is for us to sort of put our detective hat on and work out what's true and what isn't. And I think with the right philosophical fundamental assumptions, the right premises, we can actually confidently know truth. To understand reality and know truth is possible. And I think this is part of the problem, is that a lot of people feel so disillusioned that they've given up on even thinking that they can find truth.
Yeah, well, we're not taught critical thinking in schools, are we? And critical thinking is a skill that has to be developed and practiced, just like any other skill, like learning guitar, like learning to dance, or like ballet or something, learning gymnastics. Yeah. And schools don't teach it. And people, almost all adults come out of, you know, by the time they get to adulthood, they don't know how to think straight.
No. It's shocking, as you point out, that it's not taught in schools. Thinking is man's survival technique, really. If you consider it for a moment, excuse me, you know, if you were to, for example, sort of crash land in a rainforest somewhere, you can't meditate to find out what plants to eat or find out where to go or how to rest. You can't intuit it. You can't channel it. You need to think. You need to put your thinking cap on and ask yourself questions. What am I going to do? How am I going to do this? You know, what are my basic needs? And you need to think. It's an essential survival technique, and it's not, as you say, taught. It's shocking that no guidance is given, and it almost counter to that, in fact, thinking is discouraged all the way through the educational system that I would strongly advocate parents remove their children from. All through the system, we have the discouragement of individuality and of thinking, as you said, of critical thinking. I tend to consider the term critical in that phrase a redundancy, because thinking is really all you, if it's done correctly, is inherently critical thinking. All the way through the educational system, multiple choice exams, there's very little thinking involved there. It's just recognition. Mm. And even at the top end where you go to university, if you are to come up with an original thesis for which you don't have any quotes or references, i.e. it's your own, so nobody's written about it before, you would be marked down for not including references. But you could come up with something brilliant that was totally yours and you know, ultimately be penalized for doing that. So yes, thinking is tragically not addressed, and yet I would consider it right down there as the, you know, the most important fundamental.
And a lot of people don't realise that this kind of outside the box stuff that we're talking about is not going to be taught in schools, because school curriculums are government curriculums. Like economics, even at degree level economics, they're not going to be taught free market capitalism that questions the effectiveness of government, because it's going against the government, isn't it? It's a government institution. Yeah. You know, they're only going to be taught that the free market needs regulating, the banks need regulating, and the government needs to be in control of the money supply. That's all they're going to be taught. And they're not going to get the kind of information, you know, that we are, the world we live in.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. And it's, when you look at it like that, when people begin to understand that the government doesn't want to cede any of its control. It doesn't want to give people more freedom. You know, we're essentially on a tax farm. And as you said, in an example topic such as economics, there's Keynesian economics, which is very much the mainstream, and there's the sort of the antithesis of it, you could argue, would be Austrian economics. And if, I mean, I would challenge any individual potential thinker to take an issue such as economics and to look into Keynesian economics with all of its regulation, its controlled economy, its demand stimulus, and all of these things, its lack of a sound money. And you compare that with Austrian economics, which does advocate sound money, freedom, lack of regulation, a production sort of model economy where you produce first. You don't stimulate demand. You encourage production, which needs the respect of property rights and all of this sort of stuff. And I think when people really take a zoomed in look, they can see that the mainstream version of the Keynesian model is just wrong. You can just measure that against the facts of reality. You can look at it, weigh up all of these options. You can see, for example, the controlled economy always fails. You know, Soviet Russia, present day Venezuela, it can be seen. It's not a mystery. It's not I wonder whether this works or not. Mm. It can be seen that free markets, such as in the explosion of wealth creation with capitalist America, or as near as America got to capitalism in the century, you know, the 19th century, the 1800s, you can see the explosion of wealth creation and the huge increase of everyone's standard of living around the planet, which resulted from that century of economic activity. So it's not as if there's no evidence. So again, you know, I would encourage any would-be investigator to you can pick any topic you like, but economics is a good example, and you can see for yourself. If you look into it so that you're really honestly evaluating all the pros and cons and try to step outside, you know, of this mainstream narrative, you know, and again, you know, just to mention there that we have to acknowledge that this mainstream narrative, with all its clamoring about fake news and stuff, is so saturated with propaganda and with the official agenda of governments that it can't be trusted, unfortunately.
Yeah. It's like a topsy. I was watching what's that? Stranger Times. What's it called? Stranger Things. Have you seen that?
No, I haven't. No.
Okay, it's a series on Netflix, and basically there's the normal world, and then the kids get sucked through a vortex into this upside down sort of hellscape alternative reality full of demons and sort of darkness and stuff. And I don't know. Sometimes it makes me like society feels like that. Sometimes like a lot of people got like a backwards, inverted view of everything. You know, they've been taught that capitalism is what makes people poor, and it's actually, we know, it's the opposite. You know, freedom, free markets, capitalism lifts people from poverty, and you know, it's government that causes poverty and restricts, and it's so backwards, isn't it? And
it is.
Yeah, go ahead.
It is. It's difficult because when you've heard certain messages repeated again and again over decades, it's difficult to question them. And this is where it ties into this practice of thinking. If we're in the habit of asking questions, if we learn to trust our own mental activity, our own judgment, when we learn to trust that, it breaks us away from this appeal to authority. I'm sure many of your listeners have heard, you know, the appeal to authority or the appeal to majority. A lot of people, if they're not in the habit of trusting their own judgment, will quite naturally tend to look around at what everyone else thinks and believes, or what those authority figures say. And if that's the official view, if there's an expert up there on telly saying this is the way it is about this issue, there's a very great temptation to follow that, because it makes sense. It with no counter argument coming from one's own critical thinking.
yeah, a lot of it is just taken as foregone conclusions, isn't it, and not questions.
Yeah, so people have it's like a trap to fall in, isn't it? It's a trap where you have to listen to someone, or we have to know what to do, because I think ultimately the challenge is to know how to live. And if you don't know how to live, then you will necessarily feel anxious. And I think that's got a lot to do with the epidemic proportion of anxiety amongst, you know, so many sectors of society, is that we really don't know how to live. And in that context, you have to look to somewhere, because you've got to make a decision about what to do. If you're being suggested that your children must get vaccinated, and it's like, oh, I don't know what to do, you know, and in the absence of the fuller context of having all of that information at hand, you're naturally going to have to look to whoever does appear to know. And of course that is the, you know, the authority figures. The challenge is to replace the appeal to authority and the appeal to majority, ultimately to replace that, I think, with developing one's own confidence in our own mental processes.
Something I was thinking is what was I thinking? I've said this before, I think, on my podcast, is like being completely, like, some people in the alternative world are so gullible and so open to anything, and they believe anything they're told. It's all, and then on the other end of the spectrum, some people are so close-minded, you know, they're not open to anything. And both of those extremes are madness, you know, like, there's a lot of people that flirt around in the conspiracy sphere, you know, the conspiracy world, and they'll just believe anything they read, you know. And I think what I like about you, and I hope I've got a similar approach, is we sort of find that middle balance where we're sort of intelligently skeptical, we're open-minded but not gullible, you know, we question things but we don't believe nonsense. And I think that's a better approach, isn't it?
Yes, I agree with that entirely. And I like to substitute open-minded for active-minded, because I have heard the argument that if our mind is just open, like a receptive bucket for ideas to be dropped into it, this could, not always, but it could lead to us accepting the wrong ideas. So that's why I think it's very, very important to keep questioning, you know, why are these ideas true? You know, this is very important to keep this this perpetual questioning of ideas, so our own mental processes are active.
Yeah.
And then, of course, there's the other component whereby some people, or there's a tendency in all human beings, I think, to sometimes identify with ideas. So, you know, whatever the idea may be, you know, there are some people that are very passionate about being within the green movement, for example, and environmentalism, which on the face of it looks great, but it's still worth questioning the extent to which we sort of place our own identity and merge that with this sort of crusade we're on, and that's where it gets very difficult to hear both sides of a story, because there are a number of issues, environmentalism being one, you could take vaccines as another, and there are loads of them where all of the pros and cons of various views are not evenly represented in the argument. So for example, in the vaccine issue, you know, should you vaccinate your children or not, everyone is familiar with the idea, or the fact that all of the pros of vaccinating your child will be trumpeted up to the max. You know, it's really good, you've got to do it because of this and this, so all of the pros very much hammed up. But the negatives of doing that won't be mentioned. And by the same token, you've got the negatives of not vaccinating, very much shouted out at full volume, and the positives of not vaccinating, again, not mentioned. So there's just not an honest debate going on. And until we are able to entertain all of the pros and cons of all of the alternatives, you know, through this process of thinking, critical thinking, asking why is that? Okay, yeah, that I'm supposed to take that, but why? You know, and when we look at all of these issues, then you start to see that, hang about, have I really got this, have I really drawn the correct conclusions?
I completely agree. Mm. Like what you said about identifying, I completely agree with that. Because and you said about the environmentalists is, yeah, there's a lot of people where their whole way of life, their whole identity, their social circles has become completely orientated around being an environmentalist, and they're unable really to hear any arguments against them, because that would actually attack their identity and their lifestyle, and. Yeah, you're so right. These things need to be treated as information, and as like you say, as soon as people start getting on a crusade and they feel and it gives them a sense of meaning and purpose and significance, and they feel like they're doing something important in the world by rallying and campaigning, and they can't hear anything anymore. This become a religion for them.
Absolutely, it is. Once you identify to a large degree with a cause, once you've sort of merged your own identity with this issue, then of course anything that is said as a counter argument to that issue will be perceived as an attack on self, and naturally you'd be a unique human being if you didn't perceive that as attack, given that your identity has absorbed that cause. So this is why it's so important to be objective, meaning separate from all of these issues. We have to weigh them up from not that perspective where we've identified with them.
Yeah, 100%. You get the same with feminists, Oh, don't get me started on that. That's a whole kettle of fish, isn't it?
It is. There's so many issues these days, isn't it? Where you could talk about so many different categories of issues where almost the same thing is going on. People are getting very entrenched positions, and they're prepared to fight, in inverted commas, or sometimes quite literally, for their cause, when really they need to go away and perhaps, re-evaluate everything and, apply some thinking, question the fundamentals. I'm always intrigued by the environmental debate is one that I find particularly fascinating, because there are certain facts about carbon dioxide and the environment which are never mentioned, and they're always glossed over, which for me stick out like a great big elephant in the room. And I can't, I can't understand perhaps why other people don't appreciate them. But things like, it's been much warmer in the past than it is now, much warmer, and we're still here. The polar bears are still here. We've had much higher concentrations of atmospheric CO2 in the past. This is something that's not generally disputed. You could present the facts that will prove this, and yet we're still here. We didn't have any kind of thermal runaway, and you could go on with various things, and yet these facts are completely overlooked. And we have huge swathes of legislation in place already on the assumption that the planet and our whole life support system is going to be compromised unless we reduce human-made carbon dioxide emissions, which to me, I just cannot see that. There's also facts such as plants thrive on carbon dioxide. If you're growing tomatoes in a greenhouse, such as they do in Spain and various other places, you pump the greenhouse full of extra carbon dioxide in order to ensure abundant plant growth.
If
we step back and consider that, if we also consider that, back in dinosaur days, when animals were able to assume a huge bodily mass from eating all this massive nutrient-dense plant food that was around at the time, during a time when CO2 levels were much higher and there was a much greater concentration of CO2. So it amazes me that these sorts of things escape the general narrative, and it's a classic example how the mainstream narrative is so tilted. You cannot listen to the BBC News or most official sources within you know, what I would call the mainstream narrative and expect to get a balanced view, unfortunately.
Absolutely. Yeah, I really noticed that environmentalism is for most people is completely just a foregone conclusion. They won't even they won't even ever question it. It's just like it's taken as a given that we're killing the planet. We need to do this, that and the other. You know, we need to, whatever. And I'm not agreeing or disagreeing either way. I'm just saying, hang on a minute. You're treating all this as a foregone conclusion, you know, without Absolutely. Even question, you know.
Another interesting complication that's thrown into that mix in the mainstream narrative is the mixing of issues. It's something that Ayn Rand referred to as package dealing. If, for example, with environmentalism, if we separate the issues of generating carbon dioxide with pollution, okay, because those two are fused together in the mainstream debate. Now, quite clearly, pollution and airborne toxic chemicals, quite clearly and self-evidently and sensibly, pollution needs to be reduced, you know, and or with a goal of eliminating it or absolutely minimizing it. This is obviously a good idea, but that is fused with this idea of excessive carbon dioxide, you know. The two issues emerge together, and they rightly shouldn't be. When you can separate them, you know, you get a clearer understanding of the whole picture, and you're able to more sensibly evaluate things. And there's also, of course, the issue of what standard of value are we using? What is the standard of the good that is implicit in our debate? And environmentalists, notably, their standard of value is a pristine planet. So it's unspoilt nature. It's, you know, the extreme of no people there, the forest's okay all on its own. So that's their standard of value. My standard of value would be what is pro-human life. For me, what is pro my human life and what is pro everybody's human life as a collective. And this, if we remember that to be rational at all times, rational self-interest is really the key. It's entirely rational to not pollute your environment. It's entirely rational to get on with people, to trade and offer value for value, to be accommodating to some, you know, be generous, to help others. It's rational to fit in with the community. So all of these things need to be borne in mind when we weigh up our standard of value. And I think there's a tendency for people to get confused with their standard of value. Because if we started the environmental debate, for example, with, well, what is best for human life? Let's agree that what we all want to do is thrive. We all want to be able, as a community, as well as individually, to have the best lives possible. We want to be able to thrive. So, for example, with the energy and the environmental debate, that means we need energy, because you can see the direct correlation between energy use, prosperity, and a raised standard of living. You know, people not dying, basically. So there's a direct correlation with energy use. So if we take for a moment the environmentalist standard of value, which is a pristine planet with no impact, well, where's the room for human beings in that model? In that model of the ideal standard, well, we're just sort of tiptoeing around the edge of the environment, being careful not to impact it, which is going to hamper human thriving. Now, if we just look for a moment at the other side and take the standard of human thriving as value, well, then we look at that rationally and say, well, okay, we need to thrive, we need energy, we need to not pollute the environment. And you're starting, it's a completely different approach. You can weigh in the pros and cons of this form of energy, that form of energy. How much does that pollute? How much does this pollute? And you can get a far more sensible, I think, ultimately, a sensible picture of the whole debate that you're trying to engage in.
Oh, perfectly said. Yeah, I'd not thought of it like that before. Yeah, that's a great point.
This is where, I mean, there's a chap called Alex Epstein who runs a place called the Center for Industrial Progress, and he really brings some wonderful clear thinking to you know, things like the energy and the energy and the environmental debate. Well worth checking out for some of your listeners who may be interested in pursuing that.
Yeah, great. I'll get the link for that and I'll put it in the description afterwards. You make a great point. There's the anti-human sentiment in a lot of environmentalism is really apparent, isn't it?
It is. It is. I've seen it on a personal level because, as I alluded to earlier, the piece of land that I enjoy as my small holding, I'm on half of it and I co-own the whole 7 acres with my sister. It's been interesting to see her model for land use is the pristine environment model. So she wanted to use her inheritance of a piece of land of 3 acres of semi-woodland as a pristine piece of environment, a wildlife haven. So essentially her model of land use is to do nothing, to leave it alone. And her half of our piece of land lies adjacent to mine, obviously. And it is what it is. I mean, wild spaces are good, don't get me wrong. I'm not arguing against that. But there is this sort of left alone piece of land with, you know, falling down trees, and, you know, it's a bit of a hard hat area if you're to walk in there. And then on the other side of the fence, we have a managed piece of land, and it's fascinating to see the difference. One of the interesting reasons why I'm not allowed to live here or build a house here, given by the government in terms of green belt and all these reasons why you can't develop, is that I'd be compromising the wildlife if I were to live here and build a property here. What we've in fact seen is that we have an abundance of wildlife here that's arrived since I began doing what I'm doing here 20 years ago. We never used to have snakes, bats, mayflies, and all of the various air-winged pond insects that we see, all the dragonflies and so forth. Yeah, and we've got slow worms. We have all manner of frogs and newts, and so many things have come to enjoy and live in symbiosis with the human activity, which is fascinating. I mean, we are careful not to pollute, and we farm and grow food by sort of organic and biodynamic principles. You know, when we don't spray things at all. So this is also very important, of course, not polluting. But I think the interesting point is that when man engages in changing and rearranging his environment to suit himself and to suit his whole rational interests, which of course is an unpolluted environment that's productive, that nurtures all species diversity. These are all totally rational goals, and we see a better result ultimately.
Yeah, great example. Like you say, literally your piece of land is an example of one philosophy compared to the other right next door, like one that's putting nature as top priority and humanity below it, and then you've got a different hierarchy. You're putting, you know, your human family's living with nature as the first priority.
Absolutely,
and it's thriving. Yeah,
yeah. Human well-being. I think if we place human flourishment and well-being at the top of the as our main standard of value, if you like, at the top of the list of priorities, and if we're to the extent to which we're rational, and that's an important caveat, then of course it's totally rational to harbor all these species, to create a greater diversity, to not pollute and all of these things. And it can't be overestimated, really, that this caveat of rational, this is another foundational issue, which to me, it seems clear from Ayn Rand's thinking, is right at the heart of the cause of human suffering. And the extent to which human beings behave irrationally seems that always to end in suffering. It always ends in tears, to the extent that we're irrational. And that, of course, means, you know, it means pursuing ideas that can't be verified by the facts of reality. It means pursuing ideas that are not true, or that can't be borne out by scientific method.
Oh, so true. Yeah, keep going.
Yeah, I mean, you see this all the time in you know, interpersonal relationships and so forth. It can be very difficult when we know that someone is behaving irrationally. And I have to say quickly that nobody's 100% rational and nobody's 100% irrational. If you're 100% irrational, you'd be dead, because you wouldn't, you know, to feed yourself in the morning is a rational action. You know, to drink water all day so you don't dehydrate is a rational action. So everyone who's alive is rational to some extent. But we also see that very few people are consistently rational, myself included. And the extent that we are irrational, it usually ends up hurting. We usually end up, you know, hurting people in our interpersonal relationships, or very literally hurting ourselves. For example, if you know that eating healthy means avoiding pizza, donuts and Coca-Cola, you know that it's rational to avoid those. If you think, well, I feel good when I eat those things, so I'm going to do it anyway. And to that extent that you indulge in that irrational behavior, you're predisposing yourself to the suffering that will naturally be the ultimate a result, the ultimate end, if you like, if you were to pursue that course of action, you know, to its ultimate conclusion. If you were to live entirely on candy floss because you love it, candy floss and peanut butter, you would suffer. You would suffer health consequences, and it would be irrational to choose that as your main food.
I noticed in the, let's just say, I don't know what label to put on it, the lefty, hippie, far left liberal community in Bristol, there's a lot of that, which is why I left. And I live in South Wales now. I don't know if you know.
Yes, yeah.
And I noticed, like, a lot of people with kind of depression and anxiety and fatigue and various, you know, psychological, emotional problems, I noticed they've always got a bunch of barmy beliefs, like a bunch of barmy self-conflicting beliefs about the world, about society, about themselves. And I feel like I'm the only person that noticed it, because I think to myself, no wonder you're, because if you imagine like a piece of software that where the code or the equations don't resolve, and it goes around in circles, and you know, that's when the software crashes and it just can't resolve. If you've got beliefs that don't make sense and don't resolve, they're just going to be whizzing around in your mind with no resolution, no peace of mind. And that's bound to lead to, you know, psychological problems, isn't it? And I think there's something in that.
I think you're very spot on there. The analogy of thoughts and mental operating system like software is a really, really useful one, because as you rightly point out, you know, we get a bug in the computer, which has to be rational. A computer is the ultimate example and metaphor for an entirely rational system. It's all zeros and ones, isn't it? It's binary, it's logic. If this happens, you do that. And all of this is on the amazing software that we use every day. And if we consider that our minds, and particularly our subconscious mind, is like a computer, and this was an idea that Ayn Rand put out, which I think is a great one. If you consider that your subconscious is this great supercomputer, and it's effectively programmed ultimately by your conscious mind, or in the absence of your conscious mind programming it, it'll just get filled with all this cultural download, what I call the matrix, the cultural download that'll fill in the blanks. And as you say, when there are contradictions in that mental operating system, it's going to end in tears. It's going to result in anxiety and depression and not knowing what to do, because we've got all these, you know, logic loops that you alluded to, yeah, going round and round, and that they're unresolvable until we mentally join all the dots and think, well, hang on, that idea doesn't actually correspond with the facts of reality. That idea needs to be re-examined. And when we go in and introspect and think, well, hang on, what do I think about this? Well, why do I think that's a good idea? And I've got this other belief over here in my mind that actually contradicts that.
Yeah,
and as we know, contradictions don't exist in reality, and therefore they shouldn't be. We shouldn't tolerate them in our thinking and in our ideas. That should be a red flag. But yeah, the computer analogy is wonderful, and it kind of implies that every time you uncover a new piece of information, if you learn of a piece of truth, we need to take the time to integrate that into our the sum of our knowledge, if you like, to update all relevant files so that any files that are still harboring some bit of code that, that's pointing in the opposite direction need to be overwritten with that new fact, that new thing that we know to be true, you know?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, yes. I want to give an example because, like anti-capitalism is one that a lot of people have it, that like receiving is bad, like making money is greedy, profit is greedy, profit is wrong. And they end up in this self-conflicting loop, like you just said, where, you know, they obviously we need food and money to live, but then they simultaneously feel like it's wrong and guilty. And there's a lot of people end up kind of living in squalor and poverty in, you know, in the far left, because they're simultaneously guilty about needing things that, you know, whilst also needing them, you know?
Yeah. I mean, look at all the suffering of the guilt and absolutely. And then people are sort of torn because they sense this is internal conflicts. And really, what needs to be remembered is that we're standing on the benefits of capitalism while we attack capitalism, which is really irrational and illogical. People don't appreciate generally that back in the Middle Ages, you know, if we zoomed back a few hundred years, people lived in abject poverty. You know, we lived in mud huts, we ate off a dirt floor, nobody had underwear, running water, kitchens, bathrooms, central heating, no toilet paper. You know, you could go on and on and on. There was no electricity, there was nothing, there were no comforts, okay? People have lost sight of that. And all of the benefits we enjoy today literally rest on the foundation of reason, the Age of Reason. The Enlightenment was called the Age of Reason. It gave birth to the Scientific Revolution, which gave birth to the Industrial Revolution and the birth of America, and the temporary enjoyment of a period of about 100 years or so when capitalism flourished and wealth was created and all of these discoveries were made. Because it's important to note that you can't discover anything, or you disincentivize scientific discovery when you negate property rights. And you know, it's interesting to note that there were primitive steam engines and things known to exist in Egyptian times. And of course, they never amount to anything, and they never can, because the king can just confiscate it, or the emperor, or the whoever is in charge. You know, it could be the government if you live in a socialist state, a socialist tyranny, a collectivist idea. So it's so important to respect property rights in this free trade exchange, and not contradict ourselves by enjoying our computers, for example, which rest on capitalism. They you know, even though we don't have a capitalist system anymore, we have a mixed economy and so forth, and we're all drowning in regulation, we do have to realize that capitalism is the principle upon which all the stuff we enjoy rests. So yes, it's one of those mental contradictions.
Yeah. And government gets in the way and prohibits solutions anyway. You know, there's often a presumption that that government is successfully progressing us. And it's not, like with patent law and intellectual property, the government with its laws stops like innovation and the spreading of ideas, but it prohibits it. It allows companies to have a monopoly over an idea because the government enforces it. And so, you know, like I see that we would be much further ahead without that obstruction.
I agree. You know, in terms of the relevance for me here and not being able to build my own house, the government very much controls here in the United Kingdom, at least, the building of new houses. Most new house development occurs on an estate scale, where large building companies come in and they make hundreds, if not thousands, of these sort of replicated, sort of almost cardboard boxes. They're so cheaply made these days. And what happens is that development and innovation is locked in a fridge freezer. There is no evolution of house building design and innovative techniques in this environment, in this context, which is created by the regulation. And it's a classic way that you can see that if you are free, and if everyone was free to build their own house, there'd be an explosion of people experimenting with new ideas. So this is, as you say, one way in which, you know, good things, the evolution of good ideas is really hampered and locked in a fridge freezer, but by government.
Mm. And like the regulation of housing prohibits, for example, housing homeless people. Like that, we can't fill a house or a warehouse or a building full of bunk beds and stuff because there's regulations that prohibit anybody from doing that. So, I mean, homeless people could be housed relatively cheaply if there wasn't regulation that stopped it, you know?
Absolutely. My yurt, nest of yurts that we had built, were four of them joined together. They're conjoined into a little nest. Was a classic example of an affordable housing situation. You know, I mean, there's no need for people to be homeless when there's land available and there's simple technology. And whereas when I look around me and I watch the farmers spraying the local fields with glyphosate, and they're growing rapeseed oil, field beans, and wheat, and these are arguably three crops that you could do away with tomorrow, and you'd benefit humanity enormously if you did so, not to mention the glyphosate spread on them. So there's enormous land use going on, which is negative, that could be, you know, that could be rethought through. And I'm not suggesting that we, you know, build all over the countryside, but it's just questioning the model. There could be an awful lot of innovation and positive developments, as you say, without this burden of regulation.
Oh, I just thought of another question I wanted to ask you, Nigel. Are you still a pilot?
No, I retired from flying airplanes in the end of 2014. So yeah, I don't fly anymore.
Okay, so the flat Earth.
Yes.
As a pilot, what have you got to say about that?
It's just a fascinating one, isn't it? The flat Earth argument. I see this as the ultimate red herring, the ultimate rabbit hole to go down and get completely lost in a convoluted maze of ridiculous argument and counter-argument. I used to fly regularly at 41,000 feet in an Airbus A330 and sit there and admire the curvature of the Earth through the panoramic view that we're afforded sitting at the front end of an aeroplane with the front windows obviously wrapping around and the side windows to enable full visibility. And you can very clearly distinguish a curvature of the Earth. So having seen that, you know, I can't buy into that theory at all. And there are a number of things that explode that whole argument, really. It's so many theories, the theory of you know, trajectory and gravity, and there are so many theories that are adequately and sensibly accommodated by a global model of the Earth, that it seems crazy to go there. So, yeah.
There's something very entertaining. I mean, sometimes I watch those things just for the entertainment because I can't believe the madness. I mean, it's the ultimate example of conspiracy lunacy, isn't it? And people getting sucked into it. I don't know, they got nothing better to do. They're looking for some kind of sense of adventure. It's very sad, isn't it?
It does seem to be a colossal waste of people's time. And, you know, as we mentioned earlier, picking your battles and not getting lost in an eddy of inquiry. You know, as we flow down the river of life, we want to make sure that we keep making headway towards making our life the best it can be. And I think of the analogy of a little leaf on the river that's gone to the side and it's going round and round in circles, and a little pool, you know, perhaps a badger's built a dam there or something, and there it's going to go round and round and round, not flow down river, maybe get caught up in something. And I think this is very much the danger when we look too much into an issue like the flat Earth, or indeed a lot of the remedies that you and I were familiar with some years ago in terms of commerce and dealing with government. A lot of these things really need to be let go, and we need to, yeah, see the bigger picture. I like to use the analogy of sort of zooming up and getting that 30,000 foot view where you can suddenly see things that interrelate in a way that you can't when you're at ground level, metaphorically speaking, at ground level. So, you know, obviously I've been a pilot, so I remember flying down the backbone of the United Kingdom and being able to see on a clear night at cruise altitude, being able to see sort of Hull and the East Coast going down the left side. You know, I was flying south, and then being able to see Manchester literally at the same time out the other window, and you can almost see the shape of the country, and I mean, it's a wonderful vantage point, but it gives you the perspective of being able to see the interrelation between these different places, and it literally it joins the dots of our mental map. I can remember thinking, oh, yes, I can see exactly how these things or these places all interrelate. And I think it's important to use that as a metaphor, to mentally zoom out and to remember to see the big picture. It's funny. I mean, obviously, we don't want to zoom out all the time because otherwise you wouldn't learn any details. So it's a process, I think. This critical thinking that we talked about earlier is to zoom in, get information, zoom out, and see how that relates to other things, see whether it connects with other issues. Zoom back into another issue, find out something about that, zoom out again. So I find that a useful model. Maybe other people will as well.
Yeah, it's a great metaphor that. Yeah, you've got a wonderfully balanced view on all this stuff. I like the way you think.
Thank you. Yeah, well, I'd thank Ayn Rand for that, really. I mean, I couldn't recommend more her ideas. I consider her to be one of the greatest thinkers that humanity has seen. I mean, there have been an awful lot of wonderful, wonderful minds throughout human history, but she really showed me the importance of thinking fundamentally, of integrating ideas together to join dots and to get to the root causes, because so many problems these days, solutions are sought to many of the problems by finding some alleged remedy or supposed remedy, but it isn't fundamental. So until you get down to the root, you know, you can't really address a problem until you address root causes. It's a bit like the doctors, you know, giving you antibiotics to treat something, which is actually a root cause of it would be gut dysbiosis. It would be the fact that your gut bacteria are whacked out of balance already. So they're not only not addressing the root cause, but they're in fact exacerbating it.
Yeah, right.
So yeah, root cause thinking is getting right to the fundamentals is a gift of that I got from Ayn Rand, and a lot of the thinking that I use stems from her ideas, the principles. Not we're not talking specific ideas. She will give you principles to follow.
Yeah,
you know. Yeah,
that makes sense. By the way, how are you doing for time? Because I've got more things I want to ask. But
yeah, I'm happy to roll for a little bit longer. No worries.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I was just thinking. There's a few thoughts came to mind, like you talk about symptoms, and I think the body, people's attitude towards the body and health and medication is the same attitude they take towards society. In terms of, like, if the body's got an illness and a symptom, they, you know, people want to just address the symptom with a medication or, you know, a cream or a pill or whatever. And it's the same with laws, like problems in society. And, you know, when there's a problem, you know, people want a law to fix it. But it's the same with the body. It creates side effects and secondary unforeseen problems. Then you need more laws and more medications to try and squat those. And then, you know, there's more side effects. And it's like whack-a-mole, you know, it creates, and as opposed to when you think holistically in terms of, like you said, the root cause, creating health of the entire system, it's a completely different orientated outlook, isn't it, towards the body or society?
It is. And in terms of society, I think it's a fundamental premise that you can't enforce virtue. You can't force people to be good and do the right thing. Whereas on the flip side of that, if we have the appropriate standard of value and you set people free and you say, well, this is how to, you know, this is the standard of value, your own life, go away and solve your own problems. In fact, when we delegate all these problems out to individual thinking minds, it works much better. So enforcement on the society level is a fundamentally misguided approach. And then in terms of the body, yes, and it's the lack of fundamentality, isn't it? And the desire for the easiest solution, which legislation kind of speaks to, doesn't it? It's about, well, I know what, if we don't want to, you know, I don't know, pollution, we're going to legislate for it. But in fact, if everyone is educated into the idea that pollution is not in their interest or in anybody's interest, I think that's a much more fundamental way to go about it. Mm. And similarly with the body, of course, the whole mainstream medical fraternity is invested in symptom management, you know, disease management. The whole pharmaceutical behemoth, this multi-billion pound a year industry, rests on the idea of treating symptoms with drugs, which is, you know, which is really, really not the way to go if it's really well-being that we want. One of the things about the medical model again there is that when you have a drug to treat a symptom, what people don't consider is that that drug will have a whole bunch of effects, and one of them will be, you know, put in large print, and you know they'll say, oh, this drug treats that, and all the others will be put into tiny small print and called side effects. But in fact, you've still got this basket of effects, and putting them in small print doesn't make the others go away. So it just fundamentally isn't the right way to go.
I know I'm jumping around topics a little bit, but there was just another little story I wanted to tell you. I remember when I was around the period of time when I was into the Freeman stuff, and I was going to various little meetup groups and stuff, and I think I saw you in Manchester. Do you remember Vin and Dom? Do you remember those
yes.
two?
Yes, I do.
Jesus Christ, I want my money back still. But there was a guy, and he'd been following my YouTube videos, and I think we'd chatted a little bit online. And I bumped into him one day in Bristol, and I said, how you doing? He didn't seem that well. And he said, oh, not great. You know, he was a bit embarrassed. He was like, oh, I've been living in my car. I left my wife. I didn't want to give my kids any money because it's central banknotes and it's not real money. And, you know, I lost my house. And like, and he completely wrecked his entire life just for the sake of stubbornly pursuing these kind of free man on the land ideas that, you know, that he'd been watching on YouTube. And you know, there's a lesson in that, isn't there?
Absolutely. I mean, the phrase "how much suffering do you need" springs to mind, because when we find that we are pursuing a course of action that hurts, you know, if it's coming back as pain and we're not actually furthering our interests, it really does behove us to sit up and take note, to keep evaluating. Well, you know, performer, how goes it? Another thing we used to do in flying, of course, for navigating, is you keep doing gross navigational error checks. You do a how goes it? How's that going? Are we still on course? Are we still where we expected to be? And I think that's worth bearing in mind for anyone pursuing any strategy, whether it be, you know, the free man on the land strategy or anything that you're pursuing. It might be pursuing a particular diet, or, you know, if you're still obese 3 years after you tried this diet, you may want to ask yourself, you know, how's it going? Are we moving forward towards that goal, whatever that goal is we're trying to achieve? And it is a shame, isn't it, when you see people that are obviously suffering, they're obviously not moving forward. And yet their main problem, if you like, is that they're not cognizant of the fact that they're not pursuing the right strategy, if you like.
I had that moment of realization myself, which is when I gave up on a lot of that stuff, because I thought to myself, hang on a minute, I'm pursuing all these ideas for freedom, in quotes. And I look around, and normal people with normal jobs, they've got a nicer life than me. You know, they got a nice house, they got a mortgage, they got a nice car, they got a salary, they pay tax, they're not worried about it, you know, they're not stressing out over it, they go on holiday, they got a nicer life than me. And they're supposedly the sheeple that are caught in the system. And I thought, hang on a minute, something isn't right here. I need to change direction, you know, because I don't like where this is going.
No, and that's interesting. I totally get what you're saying there. But here's a thought. It reminds me of the film The Matrix. You know, I use the metaphor of The Matrix borrowed from the 1999 film with my podcast and with my work. And in that story, for those of you that are familiar with it, if you're not, I recommend the film. I'm sure loads of people are familiar with it. But there's this character in there who betrays the guys in the team. I can't remember his name off the top of my head. But he elects to get back into The Matrix. And of course, he wants the nice job and the nice house, and he wants everything. He wants to forget all about this pursuit of freedom nonsense, and he just wants a comfortable life. And this is entirely understandable. I think that the problem with taking it to that extreme, and I don't get that you're talking about that extreme, I must hasten to add, but if you are to just dive back and say, do you know what, I'm not going to question anything, I don't care about freedom, I'm just going to dive back in, I think once you've once you've looked at some of these ideas and you know what you're buying back into, I think it would remain like a splinter in your mind, as Morpheus says in the film, and you'd not be happy with yourself. You'd forever know that you've capitulated. It's like the thief who steals his money, might rob a bank, and he might go and live on a tropical island somewhere, but he'd forever know that he's a schmuck, he's a crook, and ultimately, I think the happy life rests on self-esteem, which of course rests on moral approval of yourself and your own actions. So there's a flip side to that, but this is why I think it's important to be realistic, as you pointed out. There's no point in, once you've realized that this is a pointless strategy, it's very important to back away from that and reconsider your plan, your course of action. But I think it's still a very worthy cause to champion freedom. And the way I choose to do it these days is through conversation, through rational persuasion, because freedom is, I think, an essential for humanity. It's an essential for a fully human life and a happy life. We have to be free. And as you pointed out, we are quite free, and we are free enough to have a pretty good time, but not free enough for me and not free enough for some other people. And I think things could be a lot better if we were actually free. In a lot of people don't realize that America, when it was born in 1776, was the first country in history, the first sort of society, if you like, in a country under this sort of government in a box. It was the first time that people, the individual, was actually superior to the state. So the state existed in the birth of the United States. The state existed to serve men. It really was, the cart and the horse were in the right order. You know, the horses were in front and the cart was behind. And that's the way it should be. Of course, that's not the situation these days. So political freedom is a worthy goal. But I think the only way that we're going to arrive at it is through rational persuasion, through discussing ideas, through persuading people that property rights and freedom to exchange value for value in a capitalist society is the way to go, in spite of all the propaganda to the contrary.
Mm. You said something that caught my attention. Self-esteem rests on moral approval of yourself. Do you mind just expanding? Where did you learn that? Is that your own thinking?
No, that's the thinking of Nathaniel Brandon. He wrote several books on self-esteem, and the six pillars of self-esteem probably being his ultimate pinnacle of his work. Yes, he introduced me to the idea that self-esteem has two components, really. It's one, a sense of self-efficacy, knowing how to live, knowing what to do, feeling that one is capable of living, that one is capable of undertaking any endeavor one wants to get into. So your sense of self-efficacy on one side, and then you've also got knowing that you're fundamentally good, you're fundamentally, you know, it's an approval of yourself and a moral approval. So it rests on knowing that you're doing the right thing, you know, for yourself and for others. If you have as one of your moral premises, which I don't subscribe to, by the way, as altruism, as the idea that you're morally obligated to live in service of others, and the only reason that you're here is to sacrifice your own interests to help others. If that is a premise in deep down in your subconscious, programmed in by yourself or by the society around you, if you hold that premise, you will feel good about yourself to the extent that you give and work for others. So this sense of moral approval, it isn't dependent on what your moral ideal is. It's just it's according to, and it swings upon your own premises of what is moral action. But essentially, self-esteem has been likened to the vessel which can contain your happiness. So for any individual that has no self-esteem, if you know that you've never thought about anything in your life and you haven't a clue what to do or how to live, and you always have to look around you and ask others what to do, or not necessarily ask, but, you know, by just observing society in general, you can watch what others do. If you know that about yourself, I think fundamentally your sense of self-efficacy, your confidence confidence in your ability to know how to live, to feel fit for a human life on Earth, is going to be undermined. And that has a huge impact on your capacity to feel good about you, what you've done, what you've learned, what you haven't learned. And this undermines your capacity to lead a fulfilling and happy life, ultimately.
Nigel, I notice you've got a tremendous ability to explain stuff very clearly and concisely. And you've been doing your show. What's it called?
Living Outside the Matrix is the podcast.
Yeah, yeah, right. And it's great to see you doing your show. And I'm just wondering, what's your plans with all this? What's the future? What's your goals with all this?
Well, thank you very much for that compliment, Ben. I really appreciate that. My plans for the future are really to keep putting out I can't stop digging up and finding the truth in various issues. And I've walked through several issues myself. And kind of what I do is I'm just sharing what I learn as I go. So my plan is to keep doing that I'm very much influenced by Stefan Molyneux. I don't know if any of your listeners are familiar with Stefan Molyneux.
Oh,
he's great, isn't he? He does his podcast, his philosophy show, and he comments on things and helps to give people another view, another perspective. And my goal as this carries on is to carry on doing that, really, to enjoy finding out what works and sharing what works with anybody who wants to listen, to be quite honest.
Yeah.
You know, and I love speaking to people. I like putting on these events such as we're doing in May, where we look at, you know, a broad range of issues about, you know, we remind ourselves, what's the fundamental? Well, I want to thrive. I want to have the happiest life possible. That's my goal. Mm. I've got a short time here and I want to be as happy as possible. And then from underneath that, everything stems. And it's that's my passion and my pleasure is to discuss those sorts of issues. So I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, fantastic. Yeah, I love Stefan Molyneux. He's been a huge impact on my way of thinking. I really learned to think from listening to him, I think, and also more recently Jordan Peterson as well.
Yes, absolutely. I like Jordan Peterson too. I tend to be skeptical of anybody who is a mystic, who anyone who is essentially I know he's a Christian, and whilst I respect people's choice to believe in whatever they believe in, if you were to tell me, Ben, that you believed in Father Christmas and the Easter Bunny, at the same time as me asking you, well, Ben, how do I achieve this? How do I achieve that? And you were an authority in something, supposing I was coming to you about health stuff or whatever, I can't help but feel that if that mind that I'm listening to can hold a conviction, a belief in something for which there's no evidence, because it's widely accepted that there's no evidence for the existence of God. You know, sorry, all you Christians, I don't, no offense, but I'm an atheist, and I await somebody to bring me evidence. As soon as there's some evidence to look at, I'm your man. You know, I'll look at all the evidence. But while there's none for various issues such as that, I find that for me that undermines the something about the whole picture that person presents. So whereas they can still offer you very interesting information about specifics, I'm wary of the overall worldview, if you like, presented by somebody who would claim to still believe in Father Christmas. I'd say, well, blimey, he still believes in Father Christmas. Surely, you know, what's gone wrong there, you know? And obviously there's the same amount of evidence for Father Christmas as there is for God. So, you know, or the Sky Daddy, as Stefan Molyneux likes to refer to him. So that I tend to, you know, be skeptical of a mystical view when it's part and parcel of topics that are really guiding lives, you know, as specific from, well, you know, here's how you avoid this disease, or here's how you engineer an engine to do this. You know, if somebody's telling me a specific can do, that's kind of in a different category from, you know, potentially life shaping issues.
Yeah, good point. Actually, Stefan Molyneux made me laugh once. I think one of his callers sort of asked him why he doesn't believe in God, and he said something kind of funny. He was like, it's not that I don't believe in God. I just accept that things that don't exist don't exist. It was just the way he put it. He's quite snarky sometimes, but I like that. You know, he's got a very sharp mind, isn't he?
Yeah, he has. He's great, and a big influence on me. I mean, really, he inspired me to begin to take up this conversation, really. So I owe a big debt to him for that.
Sometimes I forget. I actually did a couple of interviews with him years ago, and it was before he was so prominent as he is now. And I never play them back because my thinking was quite crude at the time, and a lot of the questions I was asking him were just seem a little bit clunky. You know, I find it a bit cringy now looking back at it. And I mean, I'd love the chance to speak to him again now that I'm more up to speed and more familiar with what he says. But so it was quite early on. But yeah, you know, I'm glad I had a chance to talk to him a few times.
Yes, well, what an honor. I tried to engage with him, and as you say, he's naturally too busy and too big, to engage with smaller people. You know, he'd, and it makes perfect rational sense, of course. He's got a big audience. He's got to provide some good content, and he talks to people like Jordan Peterson and all these other sort of big wigs. But he's great, yeah. And I totally get what you're saying. It's sometimes we can look back on our previous thinking and almost feel a sense of embarrassment about it, but then we shouldn't really, because it's just a never-ending journey, isn't it?
Yeah, it was the best at the time. Well, it's the best that I knew at the time.
Yeah.
Nigel, so I'll let you go, but I'm going to look at the event, and our listeners should as well. Outside the Matrix Summer Festival 2019.
Yep.
The
Yeah,
date
it's
is.
the date is the 24th, 25th, 26th, I believe, of or no, 25th, 26th, 27th of May. It's the bank holiday weekend in May.
Okay.
And all of the details can be found at lawfulrebel.com if anyone wants to look at the website.
Fantastic. And I tell you what, if you don't mind, there were some books and some people that you mentioned through the conversation. If you don't mind just firing across any links or any references that the listeners, you know, might want to go and click on, and any other information or words that I can put on the podcast, then that'd be really helpful.
It would be a pleasure to do that, Ben. I shall certainly do that for you.
All right then, Nigel. So I hope to see you at some point, and all the best with everything you're doing.
Great. Thank you so much,
All right.
Ben. It's been a real pleasure talking to you.
Yeah, me too.
Cheerio.
Bye for now.
Bye-bye.